Thank you, Susan. It's wonderful. Hi, it's great to be here. If you can't hear me, okay, let me know. Thank you, Susan and Cynthia and Emily and half the people in the room. And it's wonderful to be here, and Phoebe and Code Pink is one of the best peace groups I've ever seen, and anywhere you go in this country, the best places to stay are at Code Pink houses. I want to thank the Berkeley Fellowship of Unitarians. I love the UU against you idea, and I think that a Unitarian executive would be a wonderful improvement on the Unitarian executive. And I love what a Unitarian did publishing a book 150 years ago today. You know who I'm talking about? A guy named Charles Darwin. And so I think we should have a serious plan to spend the next 150 years getting Americans to read and understand The Origin of Species. 63 years ago today, we lost President Kennedy, and I think we should remember that as well, which is already always relevant. Forty-six. Yes, nobody is that old yet. Progressive Democrats of America is a group that I'm on the board of, and I admit to being much more of a progressive than a Democrat, and I have a book that advocates the radical reduction of power for a couple of major parties, and yet I find in a time when most activist groups and most labor unions are taking most of their agenda directly from the people they're trying to influence and imposing it on their membership, reversing the process of representative democracy, PDA does as good a job as of any group I know in not doing that, in having the word, the name of one of the parties in their name, and having relationships with people in power in Washington, and yet taking their agenda from their members. And if you want to find out if that's true and be part of making that and keeping that true, there are a couple of people from PDA here, Tyler Wood and Zagon Kabir, who are going to pass around sign-up sheets. So please sign up when it comes around to you, and then participate. I want to talk a little bit about the wars that are still going on and are not good wars now. It's sadly the case that were John McCain president, there would be a much bigger peace movement than there is. It's sadly the case that we've behaved as if we had a coup in November. And I grant you, we were in the habit of having coups, but we actually had an election. And after an election, you tell them how to represent you. You don't behave as if you've had a coup and stay home and let them do to you what they want to do to you. And so we have the same wars, but worse, and we have to deal with them in the same way. And we're not. We're not dealing with them in the same way. We used to go to the White House to protest the wars in order to raise awareness, in order to organize, but strategically we would tell people to pressure their Congress members in the House to cut off the money. You know, and we were building a caucus for that in the House. We never got a majority to vote against the money, but we were getting closer. And we had more commit to voting against the money than did. You know, we had 90 on a letter to Bush saying, "I will vote against the money," and at least 85 of them turned around and voted for it. But this was our strategy that we were developing and pushing. Now we tell people to call the White House and email the White House and fax the White House and ask the president to cut off his own wars. And it's a different approach, and it's not clear to me why or what sense it makes. Because obviously it would be nice if a president would end wars. I'm all for it, but I don't have much control over it. And you don't have much control over it. And the president is openly determined to ignore public opinion, as most presidents do and can do. They take 10 times the money as any senator from any industry. They're corrupted by the corporate media night and day. They can ignore whole regions of the country and still be reelected years from now. It's a very, very difficult thing to lobby a president. Journalists should expose what a president is doing. People who are considered authoritarian, authorities in Washington who have to be listened to because they've been wrong about everything up until now, it's good that they're saying get out of Afghanistan, you know. But, and there's not a limited supply of energy. The more people we organize to do more work, by all means, if you've got time to lobby the White House, lobby the White House. But our top priority ought to be on the House of Representatives. There's a congressman named David Obey who I think is an appropriate focus of a little bit of a story, because a couple of years ago, a friend of ours, many of ours, named Tina Richards, whose son had been in Iraq twice, was going back a third time, had attempted suicide a number of times, the VA wasn't helping him, she runs into Congressman Obey in the hallway. And Congressman Obey has passion, you can give him that. He's known for screaming at the top of his lungs. And he screamed at Congressman Kucinich, for example, for suggesting that the wars might have anything to do with oil. And so he speaks with Tina in the hallway, and she says, Congressman Obey, as chairman of the Appropriations Committee, as the guy who writes the bills to fund the wars, and as someone who opposes the wars, would you consider not funding them anymore? And he screams and denounces the idiot liberals who think that when you oppose a war, you shouldn't fund it, because he's going to end the war in 2007 by funding it. Right? How'd that work out for you? And so his position, and the position of most people in Washington for years, was once a year a war is started, you just have to fund it forever and ever. It's treasonous not to. It's to not support the troops. It's to strand people without bullets in a war and so forth. All of the Republicans swore this was treason up until June, when they just committed mass treason and voted against a war bill. And jump ahead to this past October, when a bunch of us went to the White House. I wanted to go to the House of Representatives. Everybody else wanted to go to the White House, so we went to the White House. And we said, you know, maybe a ninth year in Afghanistan won't really do the trick for us. Maybe eight's good. What do you think? We've done eight. We can't even envision what the goal is. Maybe let's skip the ninth one. And, you know, they were having a press conference in there with doctors, the group of doctors who wanted to reform healthcare without reforming healthcare. And we had all of these doctors who were excluded outside with us saying, you know, how about this? How about we listen to the majority who oppose the wars and end the wars, take the money and give us a real single-payer healthcare system, and take the rest and maybe free college? How would that be? You know, and, well, you know, what's the holdup? What's the problem? These are majority positions, right? Well, the problem turned out to be that there were more than 25 of us there, so we all went to jail. Because you don't have rights near the White House if there are more than 25 of you. And so the next day, the leaders of the two major branches of our government, the Democratic Party and the Republican Party, which have replaced these old three branches that you might have heard of, they go to the White House and come back out, and Senator Reid puts his arm around Nancy Pelosi and says, here's what we told the president. If he wants to escalate a war, for God's sake, escalate a war. We'll pick up the tab. Don't worry about it. Just tell us how much it costs. And, you know, which is absolutely unconstitutional. But Congressman Obey was in the meeting, too. Congressman Obey, a couple days later, puts out a lengthy press release, which he begins a key section of with the words, as an appropriator, with a capital A, appropriator, that is to say, as the guy who writes the checks. Listen up here. And he says, he essentially joins the idiot liberals. He says, maybe supporting the troops means having a little consideration whether we send them to kill and die for no good reason. Maybe we shouldn't pay to escalate this thing. Now, this is something that deserves massive encouragement, right? When you call your Congress member, call him too. It's spelled just like obey, ironically enough. Call him too and encourage him. Then, 3 days ago now, if I can keep my days straight, which I wouldn't guarantee, Congressman Obie and Congressman Murtha and some key Congress members introduce a bill with an idea that up until this week, I hadn't heard from anybody other than idiot liberals. This was a bill to create a tax to pay for the wars. Congressman Obie says if we're going to debate health care and our top moral priority is going to be to avoid spending money we don't have, why are we spending so many times more money on wars and we can't even talk about it? So we're going to have a tax to pay for the wars. Again, this has to be encouraged. Congressman McGovern has a bill that says, let's have an exit plan for Afghanistan, any exit plan. The Secretary of War should give us an exit plan. Congresswoman Barbara Lee, who's having a press conference about it tomorrow at noon at the Federal Building in Oakland, at which you should attend, has a bill that says we won't fund an escalation in Afghanistan. Now, I want to cheer and I want to criticize because these all fall drastically short of what's needed and what is easily done. And these all send the right message, but they only send a message. Congressman Murtha quoted quite openly, of course we're not going to actually try to pass this war tax bill, it's to send a message. And the idea of Congresswoman Lee's bill being passed in the House, and then you have to, I don't know what you have to be smoking to imagine it passing in the Senate, and then the President signing it. The President, who perhaps wants money for an escalation of a war, is going to sign a bill to say he can't have money for an escalation of war and not signing statement the money back in. And, you know, it is the right message. It is a good message to be sending. It is only sending a message. And there is a distinction I want to stress between saying things and doing things. Right? There's a problem with what we're saying. Right? We're saying we oppose an escalation. I oppose the whole damn war. And I understand the logic of saying first we'll stop the escalation, then we'll start the withdrawal down from there. That's not that that's not logical. But that's not how things work in Washington. In Washington, a debate is framed. And there's a right-wing position, 40,000 troops, 60,000 troops, whatever it might be. And there's a left-wing position. And if the left-wing position is keep the level of war we've got now, then the middle ground is 20,000 troops. If the left-wing position is get the hell out, then the middle ground is something of a withdrawal. And so you have to frame the debate by not censoring what you say, not trying to appeal to the imaginary people who are going to listen to you because you say you oppose an escalation but wouldn't listen to your argument opposing the war, even though it's the same argument, and making one without the other doesn't make any sense to anybody. So we have to say the right things, too. And the peace groups are not. All of the best peace groups are saying, call the President, and they're saying, tell the President you don't want an escalation. It is the wrong person to call, and it's the wrong thing to say, although it's good, it's in the right direction. Well, I got an email from Congressman Alan Grayson recently, and this is someone who does do some things. There's a bill that he's been pushing that would let Congress see what the Federal Reserve does with our money. That's doing something. Now, this is short of the constitutional requirement that Congress have complete control over our money. This is just let Congress see what the Federal Reserve does with our money. But this has made it through the Finance Committee. This has over 300 co-sponsors when you only need 218 people to pass it, right? There's a congresswoman around this general area who runs the House of Representatives who needs to allow a vote on this thing because you allow a vote and it passes. That's doing something. And Congressman Grayson does do things, but mostly what he does is say things better. And what most of what we think of as the better Congress members do is say things better. Congresswoman Lee, Congresswoman Woolsey, Congresswoman Lee, the only Congress member to vote against going into Afghanistan. You can never thank her enough for that. But mostly when we think of good Congress members, it's the ones who say things better. Congressman Grayson, a lot of what he says is good, and it's honest, and it's a refreshing break from sheer abject cowardice. But it's a pretense that the Republicans matter. And I'm sorry, Congressman, we're ahead of you. We voted them out of power. We actually want the Democrats to do something with the power we've given them. But I was excited by this one because I got this email that from Congressman Grayson that said, Dick Cheney's still on the loose. Dick Cheney's not behind bars. Hold Dick Cheney accountable. And I was a little bit excited. Could this be for real? Is he going to do something to hold Dick Cheney accountable? Can he wait for me to sell my house? I want to do what I can, you know? But and he raised over $500,000 in a day. And do you know what it was that he wanted to do? He wanted to go on television and call Dick Cheney a vampire. Which, if you will forgive me, has no teeth to it. It's talk. It's talk, 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 talk. When Congressman John Conyers held the pseudo-impeachment hearing last July, where Nancy told him he could hold an impeachment hearing, but they would have to pre-announce that they wouldn't impeach anybody no matter what they heard at the hearing, and John Conyers opens the hearing by bragging about all the hearings he's held, even when he was in the minority and working with us to hold pretend hearings on the Downing Street minutes, up through all the hearings he held through 2007, 2008, where either the witnesses didn't show up because they didn't comply with subpoenas, or they showed up and exposed massive felonies and abuses of power, and then everyone went home and had dinner. These were the two types of hearings, and he brags about these as ends in themselves, and then holds the pseudo-impeachment hearing and then goes home and has dinner, because talk, 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 talk is an end in itself with these people. So what I would love to see Congresswoman Barbara Lee say tomorrow is, we're moving these bills to send good messages, and you've got to help me push them forward, and it's the right message to be sending. But I'm also joining with my colleagues to build a public list of members of the House of Representatives who are going to vote no on any more bills that fund the wars. Because if you don't fund the wars, you don't have to pass a bill saying you don't want to fund the wars, and then pass it through the Senate, and then pass it past the President. You can do it in the House and you're done. Right? It's so much easier. Doesn't mean it's easy, it's hard as hell. But it's what we have to work for. We have to talk about the war, not just the escalation. And we have to talk about voting no on any bills that fund it. And if they put relief for Katrina victims or hate crimes legislation or free kittens for children in there, you still vote no. Because they can pass all that other stuff separately. It makes no excuse whatsoever to vote for a bad bill. In June, we had 32 Congress members vote no when it really mattered. After we had 51 pretend to vote no when it was an easy vote, and then the Senate put something else in the bill, it came back to the House, all the Republicans are now voting no for their own crazy reasons, and we only need 39 to stand by their no votes, and we only hold 32. Among those 32 were Barbara Lee and Farr and Filner and Honda and Lofgren and Speer and Waters and Watson and Woolsey. Among those who faked it and then voted yes when it mattered were Matsui and Miller and Thompson. And it matters because these Congress members almost always take their orders from the leader of their party, not from us. The president, the vice president, the generals, the cabinet secretaries, they spent over a week doing nothing but bribing and threatening these people. They told freshman Congress members, you will be dead to us. They talk like the mafia. you will be dead to us. We will not fund your next campaign. We'll fund someone to run against you. We won't put your bills in. We won't do your earmarks. There'll be no weapons factories in your district. We won't buy radio ads. We won't do crazy press events where we send White House big shots down to announce no news whatsoever in your district to put you on the front page. You will be dead to us. And we still had 32 brave souls say, I don't care. I voted no because I meant to vote no. If we get that situation again, we can get the 39 or 40 we need, no question. If we need 218, we can work to get 218. If we can find a couple long absent pieces of David Obey's anatomy, then that's all we need, only one guy. So this is a strategy that can succeed. And moving these bills is a good approach. It moves the right message. It creates measures that can be put in larger bills, but it's not enough. And it's not what you talk about. It's what you compromise on with the lousiest Congress members who won't commit to what you really want. The power to make war is part of the topic of my book because it's about where powers are. And overwhelmingly, the biggest impact on human lives in coming generations of what we do in these years is not going to be whether we pass a bill or wage a war. It's going to be where we leave powers. Because if we leave powers where we are now leaving them, we will have a series of kings, not executives. We are giving almost absolute power. All of the powers that were radically increased when Bush and Cheney were running the country, none of them are being rolled back. They are being cemented in place and they are being expanded further. The power of war is central in that it's the excuse to expand all the other powers and to strip us of our rights. Congress is supposed to have the absolute power to decide when and where we have wars. And then the president can be the executive of the Congress and the commander-in-chief of the wars as determined when and where and funded by Congress. The people who wrote the Constitution were very clear that you would not have the commander-in-chief have anything to do with deciding when and where you have a war. Who remembers what Article 1 of the Constitution is about? Yes, ma'am. The powers of Congress and everything else to do with Congress. The first 60% of the Constitution is about the most powerful branch of our government, to which they gave every power they could imagine. And the power to make war is now in the White House. We don't declare wars in Congress. Congress doesn't want to make hard decisions. Congress doesn't want to be involved. They want the president to do it. At most, you know, with something like Pakistan, they just don't call it a war. With something like Afghanistan or Iraq, they pass a vague authorization to use force. And then they put requirements in there on Iraq, and the president does not comply, but they don't pay attention. The president takes money from elsewhere and secretly begins the invasion of Iraq without any authorization, and they don't care. The authorization loses all relevance. We're not still looking for the weapons all these years later, and they still consider that the authorization. And the president can go and make a treaty with the occupied government, with a puppet, for 3 more years of war, taking the power of war and putting it in a treaty, and not ask the Senate to ratify the treaty. Which there was a senator named something like Barack Obama, I think it was, who did not approve of that. Constitutional scholar, you know. There's a senator named Biden who put in a bill that said we won't fund the occupation of Iraq anymore unless the Senate gets to ratify treaties. What is this about? Well, now the president and vice president are happy because that is their legalization of the occupation of Iraq. They're also happy that they don't have to actually comply with it. Nobody consulted a single Native American about treaties as this went along. Because when you have nothing to do with making a treaty, they can make another treaty, and another treaty, and treaties in the neighboring countries. And the Senate no longer has the power to say anything. So they did recently say we approve of the exit date at the end of 2011 in the treaty that we had no say over, and we want monthly reports from the Pentagon. But they didn't say what, if anything, they would do if they didn't get the monthly reports from the Pentagon, or they were dishonest or they were honest. They also, in Congress, eager as they are to pass the buck to the president, have not yet caught on to the idea of passing the buck to the people of Iraq. Because the Iraqi parliament said, hell no, you're not making a treaty with us. And we only approve it if the Iraqi people get to vote it up or down by July 2009, which has come and gone. And they haven't gotten to vote it up or down. They might get to in January. It looks unlikely. There may be a lot of anger in Iraq when they don't. But if Congress wanted to pass the buck to someone who would, without any doubt whatsoever, end the occupation, end it in 12 months, because the treaty says this treaty is good for 12 months if it's invalidated, pass it to raise hell about the fact that the people of Iraq should get to vote on whether or not we should keep bombing them into democracy. So the power to make war, but what about the power to make laws? Congress is supposed to make laws. They now ask the president what laws to make. The president tells them what laws to make. The president makes laws with executive orders, dropping all pretense. The president makes laws with signing statements. Yes, the current and the former president. The president makes laws with secret memos. Imagine if you could hire a lawyer. No, don't worry about the expense. Hire a lawyer to write you secret memos legalizing crimes you wanted to commit. And you put those in your pocket, and you go off and commit whatever crimes you want. Plus, you get the world's biggest military to help you, and the federal government. It's the closest thing to absolute power there's ever been in the world. The current president has told the Justice Department, you cannot prosecute these people, but you can consider prosecuting some people who strayed from the illegal policies in the secret memos, who tortured in the wrong way. You can consider that. Now, we don't know if there have been any more such secret memos created in the past 10 months, but we know damn well there will be in the next 10 years if we don't do something about it. And, you know, these memos didn't just legalize torture, legalizing quotes, that they're treated as laws legalizing something that can't be legalized. They legalized something thousands of times worse. Torture should be a footnote in all of this. There's a lovely, lovely memo that was written to Alberto Gonzalez on October 23rd, 2002, saying, yes, you can. These memos were always, yes, you can do that. Here's why it's legal. They were always replies to the White House or the CIA or the Pentagon. Yeah, you can do that. Here's why it's legal. Well, this was a memo written by the head, well, signed by the head of the Office of Legal Counsel, John Yoo's boss. You all know who that was? Jay Bybee. I'm glad this part of the country knows that. Most people don't. It's good that you know it here. You know, everybody knows John Yoo, whose house we went to this morning. He's got a beautiful view up there. He did not answer his door. He called 911, but he needs to be haunted permanently everywhere he goes. But his boss was Jay Bybee, and Jay Bybee wanted to be a judge. I'd love to be a judge. Lifetime job, total security. I get to decide which crimes to legalize. I don't have to have Alberto tell me. I can just do it. Well, how is he going to get to be a judge? He had to sign off on these secret memos legalizing blatant crimes, and then they would make him a judge. And he did, and now he is here, sitting in San Francisco, among other places on the West Coast. And what do you think he legalized? On October, and maybe John Yoo wrote it, I don't know, but Jay Bybee's name is on it. What do you think he legalized on October 23rd, 2002? Not a guess. What is the worst crime that can be committed?
Preemptive war.
Yes. He legalized illegal wars at the whim of any president. Aggressive war is now illegal. 47 pages of why, but it boils down to the first sentence that a president simply has the power to launch aggressive wars at his whim, period. And here's 18 other crazy justifications for this particular war with this particular president, but they're all redundant. He wrote this. It's down in black and white. We're sitting around waiting for the Justice Department's own report on the writing of these memos, as if we don't know that these are confessions to the most serious felonies possible, down in black and white, and we're waiting for their report, edited by you and by me and the subjects of the report. Why? Why? So, J. Bybee will be sitting in court Thursday, December 10th. Okay, the court will be there Thursday, December 10th, but he has been there in the past, and people like Susan have been there and been 3 feet away from him and told him what he needs to do and what we think of him. And the court is at 7th and Mission Streets in San Francisco, Thursday, December 10th. Be in touch with Susan, look at my website after Downing Street, look at any of the websites of the good organizations here, and you'll know when and where and what to do. John Yoo will be protested at the law school at noon on November 30th, and that needs to be big. You know, this report that they're waiting for, absurdly, that the Congress is waiting for, but also the bar waiting, we can't disbar anybody until we see this report, the universities, everybody waiting for this stupid report. Well, the Attorney General swears now it'll be out this month. When it is, the pressure has to have not gone away. The pressure needs to be intensified against these people in every area. So be a part of these actions. Condoleezza Rice is down at Stanford. William Haynes is out at Chevron. There's a crop of war criminals here who need to be taken on. Let me try to give you 10 or 12 things that I think you can do. And then I want to have questions and discussion. But I know a lot of it, thankfully, is about what can we do. So let me give you, there's thousands of good answers, but let me give you 10 or 12. Number one, try to be an engaged, good citizen activist and try as an experiment to go for a week without thinking or talking about the President of the United States. It will work wonders for you. We could put a golden crown on the President's head and make their children heirs to the throne, and we wouldn't obsess over them a millisecond more. We wouldn't waste a single additional brain cell trying to discern what's in the deepest crevices of their hearts and souls. And, you know, thinking about such things is fine. Trying to influence a president if we can is fine. Journalists need to do it. Bloggers need to do it. But if it takes you away from the most strategic activism you can do, then don't do it. And if it eats up every other conversation with useless speculation, don't do it. We're in a situation right now on healthcare where the president has gone before a joint session of Congress and sworn to the insurance companies that the so-called public option will never include more than 5% of Americans. Public now means 2 to 5% of Americans. And I was on one of the best radio shows in the country, progressive host, a couple days ago, who asks me, now, isn't the public option really a doorway to get us to single-payer healthcare? You know, even though it's not tied to government rates, it's intentionally made uncompetitive so that it doesn't compete with anything and it won't get above 5% of Americans in it. Isn't that what it is? Well, this means assuming that the Republicans are all telling the truth, and I don't know when the last time that happened was, and it assumes that the president is lying, and it assumes that the Democrats are lying, and yet it's motivated by this fantasy that the president is lying to us because he secretly wants to do better than he tells us. And it's a secret plan, and the Republicans really are right. I mean, typically in an election, you're lucky if an elected official does half of what they promised. Most of Obama's supporters in the last election thought he was going to do better than what he promised, and he was secretly pretending to be worse than what he was. Right? So setting the emperor aside for a moment, if it gets those delusions out of the way for a moment and we can sort of focus on useful things to do, might not be a bad experiment for a week. Number two, restore the checking powers of the legislative branch against the other branches. I don't mean writing checks, I mean the checking. Anybody know what two powers I might particularly have in mind? I like all of those things, but they're not exactly what I have in mind. That the power of the purse is a way to stop a president from waging a war. But when a president...
Impeachment.
Thank you. Thank you. You know, you should get like a bunch of people and go to a beach and spell out the word impeach. Impeachment is in the definition of the House of Representatives in the Constitution. It's discussed six times in greater detail than anything else. We're supposed to use it all the time. We do use it all the time compared to what we're aware of. We impeached a judge this year. Do you know what we impeached a judge this year for? No, not for swearing. Think of what it says in the Constitution. It says, the President, the Vice President, and all civil officers of the United States shall be removed from office upon impeachment for and conviction of treason, bribery, and other high crimes and misdemeanors if they involve sex and it's a Democrat. We impeached a judge for groping people, for groping his female employees, which I'm not advocating. But if you can't impeach Jay Bybee because his crimes are only down in black and white on paper and we don't have enough slides and videos, and he was a member of the executive branch and he's a right winger and Fox News would not like it, which is the number one excuse for everything from the House Judiciary Committee, then you've lost the power of impeachment. If it's only for sex and it's only for Democrats, what is it for? There's another power, though, that's short of impeachment, that's still pretty darn useful, and that was used endlessly in the years 2007 and 2008 to put up a pretense of doing something other than impeachment. You know, they had sworn in May of 06 that the president could fry babies on grills on the White House lawn and nobody was going to be impeached. But they did something else to pretend they were doing something. Not censure. Censure is... You know, it's a way of saying something. It's a way of saying, we really disapprove of you. But that's it. It doesn't force anyone to do anything. There's no punishment. There's no compelled behavior involved. It's talk. You know, it's good talk, but it's talk. I'm thinking of something that if somebody knocks on your door and gives you one, and you tell them to go to hell, you're going to jail.
A subpoena.
You cannot refuse a subpoena because you are not in the above the law class. You are in the we don't make the laws but obey them class. There are two classes of people in this country now. And they issued dozens of subpoenas. Congressman Waxman destroyed forests with his polite letters, impolite letters, subpoenas. Go back to the polite letters. They told them to go to hell. Condoleezza Stanford Rice said, I am not inclined to comply with a subpoena. Dick Cheney pre-announced in 2006, I'm not going to comply with subpoenas. And he didn't. Dozens of people simply did not comply with subpoenas. Who can tell me what inherent contempt is? And it is not that feeling when Dick Cheney comes on the television screen. Anybody have an idea? Inherent contempt. I saw Congressman on YouTube. I saw Congressman Waxman's constituents explaining it to him. He'd never heard of it. For the better part of U.S. history, up until about 75 years ago, when somebody did not comply with a subpoena from Congress, Congress enforced it. It had the inherent right to preserve its own existence, which is how they talked about it. and they would literally hold people in contempt in jail cells on Capitol Hill until they testified to the satisfaction of the committee that had subpoenaed and enforced its own subpoena. And that means not, I'm here, but I do not recall, sir, I do not recall, no, I do not recall, sir. That means to the satisfaction of the committee. And it looks medieval to us. It looks a little laughable when you read these cases of, you know, forcing someone to come in and apologize to the committee to restore the dignity of Congress. It looks like an age of dueling, you know. But they thought of Congress as something that had dignity. Imagine that. And they never lost the power. They never lost the power of enforcing their own subpoenas. They just stopped using it because they did, like they did with the War Powers Act, where they weakened the constitutional requirements on wars, they made it a statutory offense to be in contempt of Congress, and they let the Justice Department enforce it from now on. And that worked up until they started subpoenaing employees of the Justice Department and members of the same crime family, and they wouldn't enforce them. So they said, well, okay, we'll take you to court. That's a real branch of government. We'll sue you in the courts. And they get a ruling eventually, but nobody complies with the subpoenas. They just get through 2007 and 2008 by putting up this pretense of caring and start a new Congress in 2009, and to my knowledge, they have not subpoenaed a single person. They have had Karl Rove testify in an agreement, not under oath, in secret, with his lawyers, approval of the topics and so forth, but nobody else has complied at all. And so in April, these torture memos come out, not to mention the aggressive war at President's whim memo come out, and everybody says, impeach J. Biden. All the human rights groups that sat on their hands until Bush and Cheney had done every bit of damage they could possibly do and then said, let's start prosecuting some people, they all said immediately, impeach J. Biden. The New York Times, impeach J. Biden. The newspaper in Utah where he is said, impeach J. Biden. Everybody. Senator Leahy says, J. Biden, would you mind coming in and talking to us in the United States Senate? Would it trouble you in any way? Would it be an inconvenience? You might have heard of us. We're down the street from the White House. J. Biden tells them to go Cheney themselves. And Patrick Leahy says, sorry I troubled you. And that's it. That's it. They have not subpoenaed anybody. They have not impeached anybody worth impeaching. And when you don't have those powers, you don't have any other powers. You can pass good laws. Nobody has to obey them because you don't exist as a body of our government with any power to put any fear into the other bodies, which are guaranteed to abuse their power and ignore the law, which was predicted by the people who wrote the Constitution with separate branches to check their powers. And by separate branches, I do not mean the Republicans and the Democrats, who collaborate in abusing each other's powers. So number two on my list of things to do, get any committee to subpoena somebody, anybody, for God's sakes, and enforce it. You know, volunteer to be the one subpoenaed. And when Alberto Gonzalez was forced to quit and leave, it was because one congressman had put in a one-sentence bill. If these people can't do this again, write it for them. It's one sentence. It said, the House Judiciary Committee shall consider whether Alberto Gonzalez has committed impeachable offenses. Take out Alberto Gonzalez, put in J. Biden. Find one congressman or congresswoman with an ounce of decency who will put in that one-sentence bill and then start getting co-sponsors on it and put the fear of Congress into the Justice Department. And we may see justice again long before actually getting to an impeachment. But if you get to an impeachment hearing, they can't hold anything back. We can have the videos and the photos that the public can't act without. We can have anything we want. We can have them squeal on each other. They don't want an impeachment hearing. And if you can't impeach him, at least subpoena him and enforce it. And you would have a whole different ballgame in Washington. Number three, cut off the war money. I think I mentioned that. Number four, audit the Fed. I think I mentioned that. Congressman Grayson has been pushing that. Number five, health care is very relevant to all of this, because even if you think the House health care bill is better than nothing, and even if you think that when it comes back from the Senate made worse, it's still better than nothing, I disagree with you very strongly, and we can talk about that if you want, but even if you do, it's worth considering that the 57 most progressive members of the House wrote a letter in July that said, we will vote no, we will not accept a health care bill this lousy. These people say they'll vote against war funding and then they vote for it. They say they'll vote against bad health care bills in order to make it, to force it to be a better health care bill. And then they turn around and vote yes. 55 of these 57 turned around and voted yes already in the House. When they do this, they enforce the understanding that is universal in Washington that progressives can be ignored, because the progressive members in Congress can be ignored because they never do anything. They only say things that they don't mean what they say. This is not what the Blue Dogs do. They make every bill worse by swearing and meaning it that they'll vote no unless it's made worse. The progressives never make any bill better by forcing it to be better, by exacting that price, by actually saying I'll vote no. A good compromise at this point would be for those progressive members to say, you don't need 57, you probably don't need very many at all, because lots of Blue Dogs are going to vote no, and all the Republicans, you might need 15 of them, to say, I really, honest to God, I'm going to vote no, unless you put back in there, in the conference committee, Congressman Kucinich's amendment to let the state of California solve our health care problem. As the 10th Amendment, you would think, made clear. But they have to mean it, and they have to follow through. And there's no reason for anyone to believe them. It's hard to imagine how in one step they can get anyone to believe it. But they have to then follow through and vote no. And then, for the first time, progressives would have to be listened to. There would be a progressive influence on other bills, on other issues. So I think that's worth considering. And in addition on health care, I think it's worth considering something called the filibuster. Who can tell me which article of the Constitution the filibuster is in? It's not in the Constitution. It's not in the Bible. It's nowhere. It's a rule. It's a rule that we got through much of our country's history without. Since it's existed, it's been changed dramatically on numerous occasions. And 50 senators and a vice president could change it tomorrow. And you could drop the whole pretense that the Republicans matter. You could drop the whole idea that you need 60 people to pass something. You could make it 50% plus one. Californians should understand this, because on budget bills in your legislature, it's worse. It's worse than 3/5. It's 2/3. So I think it's worth forcing our senators to understand something, if we can possibly do it, and that is that we know they are keeping the filibuster there by choice, and that it's not going to take very many of them. If a handful of them swore that they would vote to throw it out when the Republicans are in power, then the Democrats would want to throw it out now. There's no reason we can't force that to happen. There's no excuse for any party to keep something so anti-democratic in place, just to pretend that the Republicans matter, just to pretend that they can't act on our behalf, just to have it for when the Republicans are back in power, thereby guaranteeing that the Republicans will get back in power because the Democrats don't do anything. Number six, pressure your representative in the House as if it were life and death, as if we were past the point where impoliteness became appropriate. Because it is. It really is. They are slaughtering people. They are giving our money to wars and Wall Street and nothing else. And if you have a congressman member who does lots of good things, reward them for those. Praise them for those. And beat the hell out of them for the bad things. It's not with us or against us. It's not they're on our team or they're on the other team. It's not they're our friend or they're our enemy. They're our representative. And we have to pressure them to do better on the bad things and praise them on anything they get right. Thanks. So, So go and take polling of where the constituents in the district are. Go and take from Open Secrets where they're getting their money. Go and take from USAspending.gov where the money is going to the weapons and the sickness industries in the district. Go and take from costofwar.com and multiply by 5 to get a reasonable number the tax money the district has put into the wars. Go to your congressmember's district office, whether they're there or not. Ask for meetings. Ask politely. Phone, fax, email. Pressure them in the local media. Pressure them with election challenges. But be willing to go to their office and sit down and not leave and cough a lot. And if you think it's a big risk and it's a federal building and they'll charge you with something crazy, talk to a lawyer and be informed. If you think you can't resist slapping a policeman, get training in how to resist slapping a policeman. You know, there are things you do not want to be charged with. But sitting in a Congress member's office to ask them to do better is enjoyable. There are medical studies that will show you it is good for your health. And it does not hurt, and it is not traumatic, and it is not difficult, and it is not costly. There are students who will do sit-ins. We need to be working with them. We need to be working with them on their understanding that a fraction of what's going to the wars and Wall Street would solve all our educational shortfalls. And if students don't come en masse to lectures, who cares if they go and sit in buildings and in Congress members' offices, where it's not just about immediate tuition issues, but it's about the bigger picture, because students are more willing to do it than older folks. And so we need to work with them, and they need to work with us, and we need to be willing to stop pretending politeness is an important value in this. It just isn't. I was in Davis a couple days, 2-3 days ago, and I'm talking to people, and they're saying, well, you know, we'd like to do all of this pressuring our Congress member. He does do everything we oppose and votes for the wars and the Wall Street bailouts. But he's a Democrat, and if we did that, we'd be helping a Republican to unseat him next year. And then I go to Grass Valley, and I say the same stuff, and they say to me, well, but we can't do that here because our Congress member's a Republican, so there's no point. My God, where can you be a citizen of this country? So I suggest perhaps everywhere, regardless of party, and that perhaps forcing someone to listen to their constituents might conceivably help them in the next election. Watch out for bad excuses not to do things. In conflict, obviously, with Barbara Lee's event, which I most highly encourage everyone to be at, there is a rally at the university at noon tomorrow at the place called Sproul Plaza. So, Sproul. I haven't said one place name correctly since I've been here. Vallejo, did I say that right? So, number 7, media. Make media at events like you're doing right now. Make media everywhere. We made lots of media. Cynthia already sent me a report this afternoon on our visit to Hughes House this morning. That's what you have to do. And there are great radio stations here. There are great publications here. Do not support any organization that buys ads in corporate newspapers opposing wars when those newspapers support the wars. Give the money to the good media outlets, and if they're not big enough, they will become bigger when you support them. We need major media reforms. It's the biggest problem we have, and it's discussed in my book, but in immediate terms, it's very easy to start supporting the good media and making it and stop supporting the bad. Number 8, educate. Educate like we're doing with books, with every form of communication and direct conversation, but educate young people, educate the kindergartners whose classrooms the military officers are coming into and showing off their uniforms. Educate everyone, because we're not going to accomplish a fraction of what we need to accomplish while we in this room are still alive. We have to educate the future. Number nine, think about what you can do at the local and state levels that you can't do very easily at the national level. Even things like, I've been at events recently where people are promoting the U.S. Department of Peace. I couldn't be more in favor of it. But I don't know why you couldn't have a California Department of Peace. All of the violence, all of the domestic violence, the gun violence, the racial violence that this would seek to address is at the local and state levels as well as nationally. And I would love to have a state with an institution moving in the direction of saying our militia, our National Guard can't fight illegal wars. We can't have military exams in our high schools. We're going to actually support our residents who refuse illegal orders. I mean, this is much more conceivable to me than quickly getting the U.S. Department of Peace, and it helps to get it. And when you pass, when states fix the campaign bribery system, when localities and states fix anything, it puts pressure to fix it nationally. And we're going to fix healthcare in a state long before we do it nationally. And that means whether or not you support Jerry Brown for governor, kick his ass until he agrees that he's going to support single-payer health care. You do not have to be with him or against him. You do not have to worship someone you support. When Jerry Brown was running before, a long time ago, the United Farm Workers were running his campaign in his office, and their colleagues from the United Farm Workers were sitting in and protesting in his office. And what came out of that but a better relationship and respect for the farm workers and what they were after? Rights. So you do not have to accept someone as they come to you. You can fix them or find someone better or both. There is a green candidate for governor as well. I would say her name, but I don't remember.
Laura Wells.
Laura Wells is another candidate for governor. There are ordinances and resolutions that can be hugely influential. Cynthia Papermaster, who's standing over there, and Susan Harmon, who's sitting back here, raise your hand. Cynthia is in Berkeley and Susan is in Oakland. And there are efforts in these places to move ordinances and resolutions, including like one that Amherst in Massachusetts has done, saying victims of Guantanamo are invited. We want them to come settle in Amherst. Amherst should not be the only place that says that. And including ordinances as passed in towns in Vermont and Maine that say, if these criminals, if Bush and Cheney and others set foot here, they shall be arrested. I actually think it would be wonderful if John Yoo couldn't leave Berkeley and go to Oakland. You know? And if Condi couldn't leave Palo Alto or wherever it is she is and go to San Francisco. I think these would be wonderful pieces of local legislation to enforce national and international standards that are blatantly being ignored. Right? When somebody like John Yoo or Jay Bybee has put down in writing that they are confessing to felonies, and the only reason they're not behind bars is that they're in the above-the-law class that's got immunity, then unless you accept that division of our society, that guy does not have academic freedom. He does not have any freedom. He is behind bars. That's where he belongs. So, you know, these people have to be protested anywhere and everywhere they go. And if cities can be moved to pass resolutions that other cities are passing that simply uphold basic principles of law, the result can be quite dramatic and put pressure on other institutions in our society. There is also with us, I'm told, this evening, gentleman named Bob Miola, who is the chair of the Peace and Justice Commission, who could play a role in doing some of this as well. You want to raise your hand? Thank you for being here. Number 10, resist recruitment, resist wars directly. There is every Wednesday a Code Pink and World Can't Wait protest at a Marine recruitment station in Berkeley. It should grow every week. There should be tabling in schools, but there should also be efforts that I know have been going on successfully around here to get more parents opting their children out of the military, quietly being told their names and contact info. And any schools that have these military tests in them should cease to have these tests being given, that many times students are not even told these are military tests, testing for skills based on which the military will pitch desirable jobs to them. Number 11, if you possibly can, in March, second half of March of next year, come to Washington, D.C., where Cindy Sheehan, who spoke here for the first time, and many, many other people are going to do what we should long since have done and nonviolently shut the place down. And you can go to peaceoftheaction.org, where it's spelled like peace, peaceoftheaction.org, and get involved and plan to be there if you can. You don't have to come to Washington. You can do the same thing here in some relevant locations, and you can do it in your congressmembers' offices, but this is something you won't want to miss if you can do it. And number 12 is not so much, and this is the last thing I'll say, is not so much a particular task as a particular way to think about what we're doing. And there is so much more support for what we're doing than we know. There's a chapter in my book that deals with polling, and most of the positions on which we're told by our televisions and our newspapers every day that we're some radical left-wing fringe group are vast majority positions in this country. And it makes people feel differently to be aware of that. And there is much more, not nearly enough, but much more activism in support of them than we know, unless we are telling each other and using good media. And there are many more successes, local, state, and national successes, than we know. And we're told of events, and they leave out of the story all of the activism that preceded and made something happen. So for people who need to know about successes and campaigns that are moving forward well, find out about them, tell them about them. Include people in your campaigns right before a success so that they have that to build on. And feel free to ask me questions about any area of work, and I'll be glad to give you examples of successes. But on the other hand, we have let our attention span dwindle, and we forget that the women most responsible for women getting to vote never saw a woman vote. And the people majorly responsible for ending slavery never saw slavery end, and so forth. People did what they had to do and enjoyed it and benefited from it. You have to admit, you're far happier working for justice than sitting home complaining about it. It is much more enjoyable as a lifestyle, and you do it. And you do it in the most strategic, fastest way possible, but you do it without overly worrying about whether you're going to win this week or in 85 years, because people will carry on. And education is part of what you're doing. So it's good to be aware of how difficult things are, of what we're up against. And if there's new information about things we're up against and why we should try this strategy instead of that one, because that one's even harder than we knew, that's important to understand intellectually. But to tell everybody in a public place like this one how hard everything is, how unfair everything is, in terms that everybody is painfully aware of, is not helpful, is not morally excusable. Right? You can have pessimism of the intellect, but you have to have that optimism of the will, because it's not an intellectual decision. It's not a matter of being wise and strategic and an insider. It is a moral disgrace. Coughing defeatism on your neighbors is like coughing the flu on your neighbors. It's a moral choice that you make, which does not mean you should tell people everything's going to be easy, and if you just make a couple phone calls, we'll have peace and justice by Tuesday. You don't play with people. You tell them how hard it is and what needs to be done and why we're all going to enjoy doing it together. And you proceed from there. So I would welcome your questions and comments or combinations thereof on any topic whatsoever. But I would repeat endlessly, as I will, rather obnoxiously perhaps through the course of this question and answer session inevitably, please stop thinking about the president, and please stop telling your neighbors that they can't succeed. Thank you.